As we reflect on our church's second core value, honor everyone, let's invite the Holy Spirit to inspire us. Will you pray with me? Oh God, may the words of my mouth, as well as the meditations and reflections of all our hearts, may they be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Many of you know that I am a competitive person. I like a good contest or challenge, which may be the reason I so resonate with how the Apostle Paul admonishes us, the church, followers of Jesus Christ, to outdo one another in showing honor. Another translation of this verse can read this way, lead the way in showing honor. What would it look like for this church and everyone connected to it to lead the way in putting into practice our church's second core value, to honor everyone? There are many references in the Bible that talk about honoring people. One that is most familiar to us comes from the Old Testament when we're reading the Ten Commandments. One of those commands tells us to honor our father and mother. 1 Peter, the second chapter, reminds us, though, that honoring is not reserved to our families only, or to our friends, or just to those people that we like. We're told to honor everyone, even if they cause us harm or hurt us, or we don't agree with them. Our bosses, our spouses, 1 Peter mentions even the emperor. We don't get to pick and choose. We're to honor all people. Another book in the New Testament, the book of James, warns against showing partiality or favoritism, preferring one group or kind to another. How quickly we are to team up, to make it about us versus them, male versus female, Gentile versus Jew, black or white, rich or poor. For all of humankind, it seems to be that the human race is addicted to division. And when this addiction to division is wedded with power, it can lead to a very dangerous direction. When people with wealth and influence and power, when they begin to scapegoat or marginalize a certain person or group of people, then we're headed in a direction that radically opposes God's will for the world, which is perfect harmony with God and with one another. And this is why the book of James warns. In these verses, the book of James reads, "My brothers and sisters, when you show favoritism, you deny the faithfulness of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has been resurrected in glory." And then the author of James goes into this story. It reads like a parable where he says, "Imagine two people entering into your meeting," or if we were meeting in person, again, one day we will. "Imagine two people entering into your worship space, and one has on a fine gold ring and is wearing fine clothes, and the other is very poor and dressed in filthy rags. Then suppose you take special notice of the person wearing fine clothing, and you say to this person, 'Sit over here in this very special place,' but to the poor person, you say, 'Sit over there,' or 'Sit at my feet.' Wouldn't you have been showing favoritism among yourselves and become evil-minded judges?" James, the second chapter. Now, there's a modern-day parable that correlates to this parable found in the book of James, and it goes like this. A man was invited to a banquet, and he arrived wearing very simple clothing. And so they asked the man to leave the room and to go into the kitchen for a handout. The man left, and he went home, and he changed clothes, this time wearing a very fine, expensive suit. He returned to the banquet, and they invited him in, and they gave him a very special place to sit. And as the guests looked on, they became startled when the food and drink was served, because this man began packing and pouring food and drink into his suit, saying these things: "Eat, coat, drink, coat." And they asked him, "What on earth are you doing?" And he said, "Obviously, it is my suit that is invited to this banquet and not me. When I came to the banquet wearing simple clothing, you turned me away. But when I came wearing this very fine suit, you invited me and welcomed me." When we honor people, we value them for who they truly are. We look past appearances. We look at not what their accomplishments are or what people say about them. We look at who they truly are, God's beloved child. We look for the essence of God in them, and we build them up and elevate them. There's one definition I came across for honoring that really, to me, illustrates what it means to honor someone. And it goes like this: We honor when we celebrate who someone is without stumbling over who they are not. Honoring others isn't just about how we treat each other. It's how we orient ourselves towards one another. It's all about how we see and understand God, and how we see and understand humanity. Which is why when you look at the first book of our Bible, first chapter, Genesis chapter 1, in the creation story, we learn that all human beings are created in the image of God. The Latin here is imago Dei, which means all of us are God bearers. One preacher likes to say, we all have some God in us. Another friend of mine says, God don't make no junk. Inside us all is the image of God, and we're to look for that essence. And sure, we're all born into sin, and we have this proclivity to make mistakes and to sin and miss the mark. But even before that proclivity to sin, we are born into this world in the image of God. And it's important to know from another letter that Paul writes that God shows no partiality. God has created us all in God's image. And when we honor others, we honor God. In a world that is bereft of this virtue of honoring, who will do it but us? Who will but us honor others in and through Jesus Christ? Let us outdo one another in showing honor. I want to close with a story that many of you have heard me preach many times in various sermons. I tend to repeat those stories or illustrations that have had a huge impact on my life. And this story grounds me as a person and a pastor. The story is about the Reverend Desmond Tutu, who is an Anglican priest in South Africa. He's a human activist. He's a well-known theologian. He's known best for his brave work in South Africa against apartheid, which was a regime that endorsed racial segregation and injustice. When Desmond Tutu was a boy, 9 years old, he remembers walking along the street with his mother when they began to notice a tall white man walking towards them. Now remember, in those days during apartheid, when a black person and a white person met on the street, it was the expectation that the black person would step into the gutter so that the white person could pass by. But on this particular day, this tall white man, before Desmond Tutu and his mother could step off the sidewalk, this man stepped aside. And as Desmond Tutu and his mother walked by, this tall white man tipped his hat toward them in a gesture of deep respect. This man was Trevor Huddleston, and he was an Anglican priest. This moment in Tutu's life deeply touched him. He asked his mom, why? Why did this man do that? And she said, because he is a man of God. At that moment, Tutu says he experienced a call into the ministry. As his mom explained that this man was an Anglican priest, he knew in that moment that he too wanted to become an Anglican priest. More importantly, he wanted to become a man of God. In what ways? In what ways can we, this week, this month, this year, in 2021, in what ways can we step off the sidewalk at home, at school, at work, in the neighborhood, when watching the news and then discussing it with our friends and colleagues? If not us, the church, followers of Jesus Christ, then who? Let's then, with God's help, let's lead the way. Let's outdo one another in showing honor. Let's honor everyone. So be it, and so it is. Amen.